I greet you all in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and it is such a privilege once again that we can join each other as we listen to God's voice speaking to us. It is such a privilege that even as we draw closer and closer to the end of this camp meeting, as we ruminate on the wonderful messages that we have heard from the various speakers, my prayer for us is that may we have a personal experience with Jesus Christ. I am convinced that Jesus can still transform lives. Jesus can still speak into our situations. Our message for today is coming from the book of Mark, Mark chapter 4, and I will read verse 39. Listen to what the Bible says in the King James Version of the Bible. And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. May God bless the reading of his word. Shall we bow our heads as we pray? Father in heaven, we thank you for yet another privilege that we can come and hear you speaking to us. Father, we have heard many wonderful messages from the manservants and maidservants that you have spoken through to deliver to us various messages. Father, we pray that today as we delve deep into your word, may we understand Jesus as an ever-present help in our time of need. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen. When you're dealing with a camp meeting theme, it is very possible to remain academic and intellectual and forget that the purpose of the gospel is to transform lives. When you look at the divinity of Christ, when you look at the Godhead, before the word became flesh, may I say that it could have been considered as an abstract concept. To think that divinity that is unapproachable, divinity that if it were to come into contact with humanity, it will totally obliterate the existence of humanity. But God decoded his divine will in terms and references that mankind could understand. And how did God manage to do this? He did it through the incarnation of the Word to become Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And so when we see Jesus of Nazareth, we see not only the revelation of Jesus Christ, but we see an understanding of the mind of God. In one of my sermons, I highlighted to you that words carry thought. Words are the vehicle that transmit thought from one entity to another. And so through the life and the incarnation of Christ, God was communicating to humanity his will. And so when we look at the life of Christ, when we look at the revelation of Jesus Christ, we must not confine it to purely abstract concepts that cannot be decoded into human understanding. But we must understand the life and the times of Christ through the historical accounts which are given in the Bible. One such historical account is found in Mark chapter 4. The Bible tells us from verse 22 that Jesus said to his disciples, "Let us cross over to the other side." If you remember that in Matthew chapter 1, when the angel appeared, it should be to Mary. The angel said to Mary, "And you shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." And the angel further explains the role of Jesus. For he quotes the prophet Isaiah when he says in Isaiah chapter 7 that unto him shall be born a child called Emmanuel, which when translated means God with us. And so we see the Emmanuel concept of Christ, not only in his existence on earth, but we see it particularly in this account. For Jesus says, "Let us cross over." But I want you to appreciate that this is not the first time that there is an account of Jesus and the disciples on the lake. In another portion of scripture, Mark chapter 6, Jesus says, cross over or go over to the other side. This to me shows the versatility of Christ. In other words, you cannot confine the miracles of Christ to one event and to one historical period. Jesus could perform many miracles at different times. That is why the Bible even says to us that even in the times past, God spoke to us in various times and in diverse manners through the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us through his Son. And so we find Emmanuel, God with us, saying to his disciples, let us cross over to the other side of the lake. Now, this is a very important detail, particularly as the plot unfolds and as the story unfolds. We find two groups of people. Allow me to group the occupants of the ship into two. Number one, you have Jesus. Number two, you have his disciples. But I want you to notice something. Whenever you have an account of Jesus of Nazareth being mentioned, I always say to my congregants and those who are watching that we must watch what Jesus is doing. Our focus must be on Jesus. And this is a calamity that has befallen the people of God. In so many instances, we forget the one who has called us into the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. We forget the one who has called us to be called his children. And we focus on other occupants of the ship. And yet we forget that the one who has invited us on a journey is conducting an activity that is contrary to the activities of our peers. Many people have made the terrible decision to leave church. Why? Because at the time that they were baptized, at the time that they accepted Christ, as they progressed in their Christian journey, they realized that the church is full of gossiping. The church is full of people who make mistakes. The church is full of people who are not committed to what they said they would be. And so because of that, they lose their focus and focus on other things. I saw not too long ago a clip on social media where a man was relating a story about a woman, if I'm not mistaken, who came to her pastor. And she came to a pastor extremely emotional and extremely discouraged. And she said, "Pastor, we've been in this church for a long time, but there are so many people who are doing so many evil things. Pastor, we want to leave this church." And the pastor, in a calm and collected voice, says to her, or hands her a glass of water. And then he says to her, "Before you leave the church, I want you to move around the church and make sure that the water does not spill." And so as she makes this, so as she exercises this duty or this assignment that the pastor had given her, and as she comes back, the pastor asks her, "Did you spill any water?" "No." "Did you see what I was doing?" "No." And the pastor drives the point home. The pastor says, "The reason you did not see what I was doing is that you were concentrating on what you were doing." The Apostle Paul, in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, after listing the heroes of faith in Hebrews chapter 11, in chapter 12, he then says to us, "Seeing therefore that we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every sin and every weight that easily pulls us back. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us." And listen to what he says. "Looking to Christ, the author and the perfecter of our faith." Many people have forgotten that the one who invited them on the journey, the one who said to them, let us cross over, they have forgotten to focus on him. And so we see as this plot in Mark chapter 4 unfolds, the Bible says to us that a storm of wind came on the lake. And as the storm and the waves were beating on the ship, and as the water was coming into the ship up to a point that the ship was about to sink, two things are noticed. But I want you to take no note of something. Before the storm comes, Mark tells us that Jesus goes into the hinder part of the ship, and he lays down on a pillow and he sleeps. And here's a question that I have for you. Both the disciples and Jesus are on the same boat. Both the disciples and Jesus are in the same storm. But the difference is what Jesus is doing versus what the disciples are doing. The disciples are looking at the intensity of the storm. But Jesus is fast asleep. The disciples are worried that their boat is in jeopardy. But Jesus is fast asleep. Here's a question I have for you. What manner of man is this that even in the midst of a terrible storm with loud thunder and the cracking of lightning, what manner of man is this has the audacity to find peace in the storm? Last time I checked, Jesus was called the Prince of Peace. And the Bible tells us that Jesus, before he leaves, he says, peace, peace I leave with you. My peace I give unto you. It is a peace that the world can never understand. So here's my question to you, friends. What is the focus of your journey? At the point that you lose sight on Jesus, you will focus on the storms that are affecting your life. You will focus on the storms which are affecting the church. Many of us are concerned about the storms which are affecting the church. The church is surrounded by storms, doctrinal storms, leadership storms, financial storms, scandalous storms, social storms, all are taking place within the confines of the community of believers. And like the disciples, we are focused on the intensity of the storm. But Jesus, the Bible tells us, Jesus is fast asleep. Let me highlight to you that Sister White in the book Desire of Ages tells us, and I will paraphrase this. She relates how the disciples cried out for the name of Jesus, but it appears that the louder they cried out, the more their voices were drowned by the storm. Many of us feel like this even in our prayer life. We are crying out to Jesus. We are looking for Jesus. That's why the songwriter was inspired to write, Master, carest thou not that we perish? How canst thou lie asleep when each moment so madly is threatening a grave in the angry deep? And he begins his song by saying, Master, the tempest is raging. The billows are tossing high. Our voices of prayer have been drowned by the storms in our lives. And as if to add insult to injury, many of us were facing financial challenges. But when COVID came along, those financial challenges were compounded by unemployment. Some of us were facing marital challenges. And when COVID came, they were compounded in that we now had to face each other and sit in our homes and live in our homes and deal with the fact that this is the person that we got married to, and we are drowned by these storms. And it appears that the louder we are crying out to Jesus, the more deafening the sound of the storms is. But the Bible tells us that Jesus is fast asleep. I love what Ellen White tells us. Sister White then says to us that in one of the flashes of lightning, they behold the image of Jesus fast asleep. I am one person who has come to a point of realizing that there are times in my Christian walk where I feel that God is not near me. To think that Emmanuel, God with us, is fast asleep. Does he not care about my situation? Is he not concerned about my troubles? Is he not worried about my future? Emmanuel, how can you sleep when each moment so madly is threatening? A grave in the angry deep. Now, I want you to realize something. There are two conflicting things that the disciples must face, which are simultaneously taking place. On one end, there is the experience from their past, the experience of being fishermen. May I suggest that this was not the first time that they faced a storm? For as fishermen, they understood how to deal with storms. But on the other side, they are on a journey and the one who has invited them is fast asleep. Dear friends, sometimes we want our experience. It may be our financial experience. It may be our educational experience. It may be our professional experience. When we are faced with the storms of our lives, we have a general human tendency to make our experiences kick in. But the Bible tells us that Jesus was fast asleep. And finally, when they catch a glimpse of the sleeping body of Jesus Christ, they go to him and they wake him up. And the first thing that they inquire is, "Master, carest thou not that we perish?" But I want to interrogate the concept of we. And here's a question which I have. When the disciples said, "Master, carest thou not that we perish?" Who were they referring to? Because if they were referring to both themselves and to Jesus, I would suggest that that was a question of foolishness. Because it is clear that if Jesus can sleep, he is not worried about perishing. Because perishing will not take place. On the other hand, were the disciples referring to themselves? So if they were referring to themselves, how can they say, Master, carest thou not that we perish, when the Master is on the same boat that is facing the same storm? Sometimes the situations in our lives can eclipse the truth that is standing and staring us right in the face. Disciples, what is wrong with you? The storm is beating on the same boat that Jesus is on. They are on the same boat with Jesus in the same storm, on the same lake. Why would you think that perishing is the first option? May I suggest to you, friends, that when you do not have faith, faith allows you to see beyond your current circumstances. And when that faith is not there, you superimpose things which Christ has not highlighted. Bible tells us that Jesus wakes up. And as Jesus wakes up, he stands in the midst of a storm. And he lifts up his hands and he says, "Peace, be still." And I love this. But there's something I want you to pick. I want you to pick that Jesus does not talk to them first. But Jesus speaks to the storm. Now, the Greek word used there suggests that Jesus muzzles the storm. Literally, when you translate it in a literal sense, Jesus was literally saying to the storm, "Shut up." In other words, when you look at those who take care of the dogs, you know that if a dog is vicious, they will muzzle it. They may not necessarily kill it, but they will simply muzzle it. So the dog is there, but its ability to inflict pain and fear on you has been disarmed. In other words, when you look at it in that context, you begin to see the beauty and the versatility of Christ, that some storms in our lives are not necessarily obliterated. They are simply made impotent. They are simply removed of their potency, and they are removed of their power to expose our fear. What did Pastor Moyo say? Pastor Moyo is saying that the fear, that the disciples had was not created by the storm, but the fear was simply exposed by the presence of the storm. Listen to what Pastor Moyo is saying. Pastor Moyo is saying to you, the situations in our lives do not create fear in us, but they simply reveal our level of fear, our presence of fear or absence of it. So sometimes when things are moving well, it doesn't mean we are fearless. If you want to see the condition of a man's fear, put him in a situation that exposes his fear. And I fear dogs. I have a fear for vicious dogs. Because when I was younger and I visited some place, I was told that the dog does not bite, only to be bitten. And I was extremely scared, and I went through trauma. So right now, if there is no dog around me, my sense of fear is not ignited. But that does not mean that my fear does not exist. But when I'm in the presence of a dog, that presence or that trigger then reveals to those who are around me my level of fear. Friends, I want you to understand this, that Jesus could sleep in the midst of a terrible storm. Why? Because Jesus was not preconditioned to fear. So the storms in our lives are God's mechanism of revealing our state of mind. The storms in our lives are God's mechanism of revealing to us the state of our fear, the condition of our minds. Friends, I want you to appreciate this, that sometimes even the presence of Jesus in a storm does not remove our fear. In fact, when we see Jesus fast asleep in the same boat and in the same sea and in the same storm, our fear causes us to accuse him of carelessness. Because in their state of fear and panic, they asked Jesus, literally, they interrogated Jesus, "Carest thou not that we perish?" So friends, I want you to understand that this is why the Apostle Paul, when he speaks to Timothy, he says, "For we have not been given a spirit of fear, but of a sound mind." The Bible says to us, "Perfect love casteth out fear." Because where there's fear, we can never fully experience the presence and the peace that comes with the presence of Christ. So Jesus says to the storm, "Keep quiet." There are many storms in our lives that Jesus has silenced. And so Jesus turns to his disciples. But I want you to notice something. Jesus does not begin to submit a thesis about the intensity of the storm. Jesus does not begin to reveal to them the intensity and the rage of the storm. Instead, Jesus interrogates them. And he says, "Why were you afraid? How is it that you have no faith?" Friends, I want you to understand this. Worshipping God by faith removes fear that results from a lack of faith. This is why the Bible says to us, when God comes back, when Jesus comes back, will he find faith on earth? Now, the fear I'm talking about is different from the one that is spoken in the book of Revelation. Fear God and keep his commandments, because that fear is a reverence. It is an awe. But the fear that the disciples are addressed by Christ is a fear that eclipses our vision of Christ. So Jesus looks at them and he says, why are you afraid? Friends, I want to submit to you that in the crisis of our lives, Jesus questions our faith. He doesn't look at the intensity of our storms. Yes, our children have gone off the rails. Yes, our spouses have gone amok. Yes, our financial situation is hopeless. Yes, our emotions are haywire. We're in a deep pit of depression. But in the midst of that storm, Jesus says, why are you afraid? Where is your faith? Ellen White, when she speaks of the last days, she says, in the last days, we will require a faith that endures hunger and tribulation. I want to pray for someone. I want to pray for someone who needs their faith to be strengthened. We don't need to focus on the intensity of the calamities and the storms which are around us. We don't need to focus on the intensity of the troubles which are pressing us on every side. For the Apostle Paul says to us, we are hard pressed on every side. But Jesus wants us to focus on him. Where is your faith? For many years you've been in the church, and all of a sudden, because of COVID, you find yourself unemployed. The question is, where is your faith? All of a sudden, when you thought that you were moving well and everything was fine, your children were obedient, God comes and he says, in that crisis, where is your faith? Above all, when we see the level of worldliness that is coming into God's church, Jesus says, where is your faith? I want to pray for someone. I want us to have a faith that holds on to the promises of God. I want us to have a faith that holds on to the revelation of Jesus Christ, because Emmanuel, God with us, declares, where is your faith? Don't worry about the storm. Focus on the one who invited you. Don't worry about the winds and the waves. Don't worry that the boat appears to be in jeopardy. Focus on him who said, let us cross over. May God bless you. May God be with you. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the faith that goes beyond our imagination. Help us, Father, to hold on to you. Help us to hold on to that faith. We are pressed by so many storms in our lives. And yet it is so easy to focus on the storms along the journey and forget the one who said to us, let us cross over. Father, I want to pray for your children that in a special way may you strengthen our faith. Draw us closer to you, Father. We are tormented by our past, tormented by the challenges that we face in a foreign land. Father, we pray for our families. We pray for our children. We pray for the church. Above all, may you draw us closer to you. Thank you so much, Heavenly Father, for hearing this prayer. For we have prayed in your loving and precious name. Amen. May God bless you. May God be with you. Amen.